I want to share the word today. I want to bring you a victorious message. I want to speak to you this morning about the eyes and the ears of faith. If you'll learn how to use your spiritual eyes and your spiritual ears, it will not only increase the level of your faith, but it will also drop the level of your stress in life. How many of you say, I need a little less stress in my life, all right? Then this message is for you. Now, I first learned about the eyes and ears of faith when I was a Bible college student in Minneapolis, Minnesota, at my alma mater, North Central University. And our college president in those days, this was in the early 80s, all right, his name was Dr. Don Argue, and he was believing God for the expansion of our campus in a gymnasium. And if I saw him do it once, I must have seen it 100 times. He would take his hand like this, and he would say, how many of you can hear by faith the sound of the basketballs in the new gymnasium? And he would do this. He was teaching all these ministerial students, you've got spiritual ears. Can you hear the sound of the basketballs? And then he would point to his eyes. He says, how many with your mind's eye, with the eye of faith, how many of you can see that new building going up? And we would all agree. And by the way, by the time I was a senior, that gymnasium became a reality. That was a long time ago now. But anyway, we learned about the eyes and ears of faith. And I'll have you know that eyes and ears of faith, they're not just for pastors, evangelists, missionaries, and people in ministry. They're for every single one of us. Did you know the eyes and ears of faith work in the business world? Hello. The eyes and faith and ears of faith work in your family, in all the tests of life. How many have ever been through a test? Come on. In all the tests of life, you need eyes and ears of faith as you believe God for advancement. How many of you want to go forward in life? Come on. Do you want to move forward as you believe God for advancement for yourself, for your life, for your ministry, for your home, for your family? You need eyes and ears of faith, because if you're a believer, you can't really just live using your natural eyes. Natural eyes don't see everything, and you're going to get discouraged if the only thing you see and observe around you is what you see in the natural. The natural can be very discouraging. But I'm going to tell you something. When you have spiritual eyes, you have eyes of faith and you can believe. Amen. And so this is a message for believers. And I want to give you today, a little later on in this message, I want to give you 2 Old Testament examples. Now, I tell you, I love the Word of God. How many of you love the Bible? Come on. I love the Word of God. And I'm a New Testament believer underneath the New Covenant. I've got better promises than in the Old Testament, in the Old Covenant, in the Old Testament. But I have discovered something, that as I study the Old Testament, the New Testament comes alive to me. It is the example that I find in the Old Testament that show me how to live in the new. And so as Paul in 1 Corinthians was writing to the believers there, he was encouraging them to live right and follow God. And he gives a powerful truth that I believe is for the entire Old Testament. This is what Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 10:11. He said, now all these things, what's he talking about? All the stuff that happened in the Old Testament, all these things happened to them as an example, and they were written for our admonition. In other words, that whole Old Testament, we're not to just take it and cast it aside. We're to read it because those things that happened to all those people back in those days, there are examples. There are examples today, and they were written for you and for me, upon whom the ends of the ages have come. So in order to live a life of faith, we've got to learn how to see with the eyes of faith. Now, there are a lot of Christians today that the only eyes that they ever use are their natural eyes. When something negative happens, they only see the bad. They focus on temporary circumstances and the feelings that they have, the downs of life. Can I say that could get really discouraging? And I want to take an illustration today. I want to be a little silly with it today. How many of you let me do that, all right? I'm going to just go kind of to the extreme today. But if all you ever see with your natural eyes, even in the great country like America, how many of you love the USA? Come on. This is a great place to live and work and breathe and die. Come on. But if all you ever see is with your natural eyes, life can be discouraging. Can I tell you why? Did you know what the death rate is of human beings? 100%. 100% of us grow old and we die. Now, that doesn't sound too fun, does it? And so looking at that from the natural eyes, you think, well, what's in my future? You know, old folks home and, you know, cemeteries and obituaries and, you know, funeral services and memorial. You know, we can look at it through that. Let me tell you something, that can get really discouraging, come on. And I'll tell you, as I was writing this sermon this week, I got the news that a dear friend of mine had passed away. His name is Sidney Eckerson. Sidney was the father of my three best friends while I was in high school, all right? And I spent a lot of time at his house, and Sidney was a part of our church family there, and I love that guy. He was an awesome guy. And so if you just look at Sidney's life and think, well, man, he's gone, that's it. You look at it with natural eyes. You know, well, a person can get really discouraged about that. But let me tell you something. If you see Sidney's death through the eyes of faith, man, this guy was a true believer. Hello, I'm telling you, Sidney's not ever going to have another day of pain. He's going to have a glorified body one day. He's going to in the presence of the Lord. Come on, the word says it's far better to depart and be with Christ than it is to even stay on this planet. How many of you know that all of a sudden, seeing with the eyes of faith, all of a sudden, guess what happens? You start feeling better. Amen. Because we don't walk by faith. We don't walk by sight. We walk by faith. I'm actually happy for Sidney. And in the New Testament, Paul teaches us to see with the eyes of faith. Let me read for you 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 7. It says this: for we walk by faith, not by sight. Paul is talking here about natural sight. We don't go by what we see in the natural. Hello? That's not the most important thing. We walk by what we see in faith. And so can I take that little simple illustration of Sidney's homegoing and tell you how it affects me, right? Because when I see it through the eyes of faith, you want to know what happens? The eyes of my understanding become enlightened. Right? The eyes of faith produce understanding. It produces understanding about what's really happening in the world. And when I have that understanding, guess what happens? All of a sudden, I have hope. Not just for Sidney, but for you and for me. Come on, how many of you have the hope of heaven? Right? We have hope. Let me tell you something. When you see through the eyes of faith, you always see hope. You say, well, it looks desperate and dead and dark. And let me tell you something, there's nothing so desperate and dark that there can't be hope. Come on. As long as God is in it, there's hope. Come on. Amen. There's hope. And then we also realize, you know, our understanding realizes what riches we have as an inheritance. I don't know about you, but I've got a great inheritance laid up in heaven for me. Amen. It's not that I earned it. No, sir, it was given to me by faith. I'm talking about all of heaven and eternity and being with God. Come on, somebody. Are you happy about heaven? I suddenly realize also the greatness of our God and the power that He has. Amen. So when we think of the inheritance, we think of the promises that God has given us. When we think of all of His blessings, we think of how great God's power is. Let me read to you the scripture that talks about this. Ephesians 1, 18 and 19 says this, that the eyes of your understanding, that's the eyes of your faith, right? The eyes of your understanding being enlightened that you might know what? What is faith? What do the eyes of faith produce in us? It produces hope. Come on. Tell your neighbor, I got hope today because I got spiritual eyes. When you walk into that business deal, sir, I want you to walk in there firm like this. You don't want to know why? Because you've got hope. You've got the Holy Spirit with you. You've got all the wisdom that you need. Come on, somebody. You've got hope. You see it with the eyes of faith. And you have the promise. It says, our eyes of your understanding being enlightened that you might know what is the hope of His calling. What are the riches of the glory of His inheritance in the saints? Amen. Amen. All of the promises of God come to us. And I like this last part. What is the exceeding greatness of His power toward us who believe? Come on. I'm talking about people. Do I got any believers in the house today? I got some believers I'm preaching to today. You know something? When you believe, God's power is great for you. God's power is on your side. God's power is right there for you. Come on, somebody. Amen. The power of God to believe according to the working of his mighty power. And by the way, that goes on to say that raised Christ from the dead. Did you know that the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead can work in you and through you and for you? Come on, somebody. I'm telling you, we've got to have eyes of faith to see. You want to know why? So we can have hope, so we can claim the promises, and so that we can see God's power at work. Now, let me give you an Old Testament example today, all right? I've always loved this story. King of Syria was after the king of Israel. Tell your neighbor, nothing seems to change. Come on. How many know that's true? Always trouble in the Mideast. Come on. And the king of Syria is trying to kill the king of Israel, but he's getting frustrated. You want to know why? Because there's this prophet named Elisha, and every time the king of Israel says, I'm going to go to where he is, Elisha warns the king of Israel, and all of a sudden he's not there anymore. So the king of Syria is going all over the country, and finally the king of Syria calls all of his guys and goes, all right, which two of you guys are for Israel here? I mean, you know, someone is, you know, who's working against us? And they say, no, it's not us. You know, it's not the king of Israel that he knows everything. It's this rascal prophet by the name of Elisha. So the king of Syria says, all right, we'll get him. All right, so the king decides to go after Elisha so that once he's gone, he can get the king of Israel, all right? And so how many of you know that in the natural, that should have been an easy thing to do, right? He knew where he was. He found out where he was. It's all of Syria and Syrian armies against this little old guy named Elisha and his little, feeble little Gehazi, you know, his little servant that's with him. It should have been an easy thing. And so all of a sudden, Elisha's in the city of Dothan, and it's a little town. It's unprotected. Let me just pick up the story here in 2 Kings. It says this. Therefore he sent horses and chariots and a great army there, and they came by night and surrounded the city. And when the servant of the man arose early and went out, there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. Wow, how'd you like to wake up to that? Imagine getting up tomorrow morning, looking out the window, and all the tanks are all around, and you imagine how you would feel. So he said, and his servant said to him, alas, my master, what shall we do? Now, how many of you know, when all you see is with the natural eyes, guess what it's easy to do? Hit the panic button. If all you see is with the natural eyes, it's easy to hit the panic button. Amen? And you can see that this servant here had a lot of stress by viewing with his natural eyes. Because you see, he knew what Elisha had been up to. He might have even been the one that carried the message to the king of Israel. He knew that this king of Syria was after him. And he knew what an army with swords and spears could do. All he could see was, man, we are in trouble now. And so he says, alas, my master. Let me ask you something. Have you ever looked at the circumstances of your life and you looked at it and you had to look up to God and go, alas, my master. Oh, no. What's going on? What's happening to me? What are we going to do now, God? The bills are greater than the income. The ministry struggles. I just met somebody in the cafe and they told me they were from China. They sneezed all over me. What am I going to do now? Y'all need to watch the news a little more. Come on. You feel surrounded. You feel outnumbered. And in the natural, everything says you'll never turn this around. What you need to do is to be able to see with the eyes of faith. Come on. How many of you say, I want to see with my eyes of faith? What happened next? So Elisha answered him and said, Gehazi, man, don't worry. Do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Gehazi's looking around. He's like, one, two. There's about 50 shepherds in this little town of Dothan. Have you looked around you, Mr. Elisha? Did you not see that there's thousands and thousands of soldiers encamped all around us? What are you smoking? Come on. What have you been drinking? I don't understand what you're talking about. He didn't say all that. That was there for literary purposes. All right.